All right, it's time for another beer, rum, and rock and roll rock shot. This time, Reed and I are celebrating the 40th anniversary of the Scorpions' 8th studio album, Blackout. Released on March 29, 1982 on Mercury Records, it was their commercial breakthrough in the US, going to number 10 on the Billboard charts. The album was produced and engineered by Dieter Dierks, who had worked with the band on their previous 5 albums. The band consisted of Rudolf Schenker, guitars and backing vocals, Francis Buchholz, bass and backing vocals, Klaus Meine, lead vocals, Herman Rarebell, drums and backing vocals, and Matthias Jabs, guitars and backing vocals. All right, Reed, are you pumped? You ready to have a blackout?
Really have a blackout, baby!
As you can see, I got my Scorpions North American 1982 t-shirt on, ready to roll.
1982, really? Wow.
Oh, yeah. I got this bad boy.
Oh, yeah.
Now, this one's mint. This is funny. I got a kick out of it when I dug it out. It's got this great live shot, right?
Right. Wow, I forgot all about that.
What's funny to me about it, it's got tack holes in the corners because I would obviously stick it to the wall, right?
Yeah.
Got the lyric sheet on the back. But yeah, I mean, that's really sums up this band for me. Look at that. These guys are going for it.
Yeah, and they did.
Oh my God.
I'm sure we'll get into.
Which we will get into, yes. Okay, like my first question, as usual, Reed, is give me your earliest recollection of buying this album or hearing this album and talk about the impact, man.
This album really was my introduction to the Scorpions. Like, I certainly had seen their albums, you know, looked at the boobies on the album covers on some of their earlier albums. For whatever reason, I'd never been exposed to the Scorpions. And when this album came out, we were all like, holy crap. And we immediately went and bought everything we could get our hands on. After I heard this album, I was like, oh my God, this may be the perfect album. You know, I mean, my life centered around hard rock at that time, but I'd been born and raised and brought up on AM radio, so I love me a pop song. And the Scorpions may have been the most perfect band to be able to put together the hard rock and higher energy, great guitar solos, great parts, but also give you a song with a hook.
Yep.
For days.
And those melodic leads, oh, absolutely.
Melodic leads, melodic songs, you know, great choruses, yep. Especially in this era, you know. I grew to really appreciate Love Drive and Animal Magnetism and that kind of stuff too. And even earlier stuff, but I do have to say for me, let me just say that Blackout to me is their crowning achievement. Love at First Sting had some great songs. You know, it had Rock You Like a Hurricane. It's great. But it wasn't as magical as Blackout.
I agree. Now, were you like me? So you hear this. I remember seeing the video for No One Like You. I was a big video guy. And I'm like, fuck, this is awesome. You go through the back catalog. You get Love Drive. You get Animal Magnetism. I'm like, man, there's a lot of albums. So I remember I bought the best of the Scorpions. And it was the best of the Uli, John Roth years. And I remember thinking, well, this sounds nothing like this band. Like, this is a completely different band. I liked it. I didn't like it as much, but I did grow to really love it.
Yeah, me too. I mean, you could kind of follow the thread of where Blackout era Scorpions came from when you heard some of the earlier stuff, Robot Man and stuff like that. You could kind of go, oh, okay, I can follow this thread. But I mean, people forget that Scorpions were around for years and years before that.
Yeah, absolutely. The other thing I want to mention is the, let me hold it up again. The cover art, I always thought was Rudolf Schenker. It's not. It's the artist himself. It looks exactly like him.
Right? It does. I mean, I think we all sort of, you know, thought that as well. I don't know that we ever talked about it, but I mean.
Right. In the video, he puts this stuff on too, Rudolf does, right. So to add to the, but yeah. It's a dead ringer. Let's talk about Klaus just briefly before we get into these tracks. Like how, you know, even as a kid, you could tell English wasn't his first language. Like he just had a weird way of phrasing and stuff. And it was just cool.
Yeah. I mean, it was cool sometimes and other times. I mean, I'm not going to lie. We did have a few chuckles about it at times. but not enough to take us out of going, yeah, it's still fucking wicked though.
Yeah, it made it unique, I guess is what I'm saying. It was unique, you know.
Yeah, I mean, there's times when it's definitely like, you know, whoever interpreted that should have put a little bit more time into it. How about this? Hey, let's go. Don't put on a show. You're just another piece of meat.
Most of that stuff was written by Herman Rarebell, the drummer, eh?
Yeah, Herman.
He was a bit of a perv, I think, old Herman. His lyrics are filthy.
Well, was he though, or was he just German?
Hello. Now I'm thinking of Sprockets. Dieter.
Yeah. I mean, you have to wonder how much of that stuff was just kind of misinterpreted, like him trying to fit in with the Western bands, and do you know what I mean? Well, what do the Western bands write about? Oh, girls, we can do that too. We're German.
That's right. I wanted to ask you the first time you saw them. Mine was Love at First Sting tour at the Corral, which doesn't exist anymore. But 1984 with Bon Jovi opening. That was my first Scorpion show. I just wondered what yours was.
Mine was a headline show at the Max Bell on this tour, on Blackout. Oh,
you caught the Blackout tour.
It was a double bill with Maiden, but Scorpions played last. Maiden were promoting Number of the Beast, a little album called Number of the Beast.
You were at that show, you bastard.
And they had Girl School opening the show.
Dude, that one haunts me. Yeah, that would have been incredible.
It's in my top five shows, I think. It was unbelievable. We were into those two bands so hardcore. And for me, those were both bands at their pinnacle.
Okay, Reed, let's dive into this music. I got a couple fun facts. You know I like to do that. How about Klaus losing his voice during the writing process, had to go undergo surgery. They said he'd never sing again. Like, what? Yeah, Shanker's like, no, we're waiting. This is not happening. We're waiting for this guy to get healthy. So they waited however long that was, and look what happened, right? But the doctor said, yeah, find something else to do. Like, what?
Yeah, and apparently, you know, there's all these, depending on what you read, like Don Dokken helped them out.
That was my second fun fact. The demos have Don Dokken on them.
I mean, who picked Don Dokken? It was probably Klaus. He was like, oh, God, I hope they don't pick someone good.
Check. But he is on the album, hey? He is singing background vocals on it. That's enough.
Where he belongs.
That's right. But I do like Dokken. Anyway, sidebar. Okay, 9 tracks. Running time, just under 37 minutes. So again, at this time, this time period, these albums are shorter, man, because they got to fit on vinyl and all the rest of it. But it's all killer. It's not one of these bloated albums where only half of it's any good. Number one, Blackout.
Is there a better opening song on any rock record ever in the history of all time than Blackout?
Incredible. That riff and then the there dive bomb.
I mean, by the time we heard dink, 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 I was already like, this is fucking great.
Music is written by Rudolf Schenker. This guy can write a riff. And lyrics are by Klaus and Rarebell. And this chick, Sonia Kittleson. I don't know who that is, but she had some hand in the lyrics. So there you go. But yeah, it's a ripping fucking riff. I mean, come on.
The second guitar comes in with that kind of cock log. You know, I mean, it's just fucking amazing. Takes a tiny step back when he comes in with the heavy, heavy accent. You know what I mean? It's like, what the fuck is he saying? Oh, well, whatever.
I'm too wrecked to care anyway. Yeah.
I look around. I see this face. What the hell? Have I lost my taste?
How about Matthias's solo? That solo is fucking ripping.
Man, you know, Michael Schenker obviously in his affiliation with the Scorpions. I mean, Michael Schenker is a legend and he is a fantastic guitar player. But as a kid, I was always like, what the fuck are they always talking about Michael Schenker for? Matthias is the shit.
Me too, dude. I love Matthias.
I grew to love and appreciate Schenker's work as well. But Matthias, that guy can throw together a solo like nobody's business.
That you're humming all day long.
But it's not just, you know, simple melodies. He can rip it up too.
Oh, yeah. Like, that Explorer with the stripes on it. Come on. Really cool. Okay, number two, Can't Live Without You. Music by Rudolf Schenker and lyrics by Klaus again. I'll admit, I don't love the chorus. It's a bit too, can't live without you.
It's pretty simple. It just follows the riff, right? It's like we couldn't think of anything new, so we just...
It's a bit poppy for me, but I love the verse, the stop-start thing they do. Yeah.
Or whatever they do.
I mean, that's bitching. And I also love the bridge to the guitar solo, that stand up and shout, get ready to rock. That's also cool.
Here's the thing, is that this song probably doesn't hold up as well as a lot of their other material does, but it was a good second song on the album. Like the way it just comes in, you know, one, two, three, four. Was money. I remember we played that in our basement band and we dug the shit out of it. We loved it, you know, as kids.
The good outweighs the bad for sure.
It does. It was in spirit. It's great, even though it may not be the high point of their musical output, shall we say. And it leads right into one of the greatest heavy ballads ever.
You know, I don't even think of this as a ballad. That's how fucking cool it is. We're talking about No One Like You, track number three, obviously. But yeah.
It is a ballad, but it's just fucking so kick-ass.
It really is. It's their first number one hit in the U.S. This is what's breaking the album, right? Mm-hmm. You got music by Schenker, lyrics by Klaus again. You know what I like about it, Reed? And I feel like I felt it was unique at the time, is it starts with a guitar solo right off the fucking top. Like Saxon did a lot of that.
You know what? Here's the thing. It is technically a solo, but it's a melodic theme. And they give you that theme, and then that theme comes back. It's a hook. And in that way, it's better than starting with a guitar solo. It's like orchestrated, like a written piece of music. You know what I mean? And in the most amazing way, too. Bat, dooner, wee. You know what I mean? Like everything about the way it comes in is just perfect. And then, so then you're right. It's pretty loud, like dynamically up. And then it drops down for that verse.
Yes.
And they got you.
They got
you. By the time you get through the verse and get back to the chorus, there's no one like you. Dan it, dan it, dan it. You know what I mean? Like, come on. They definitely had honed it by this point where they were like, everything just lined up.
Yep, you know? Absolutely.
I mean, this one's a love song. You're walking close to the cheese as soon as you have a ballad. And
you're right saying, on the cheese edge. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, they pulled it off.
They did, man. We should touch on the video. I remember, again, I loved fucking Much Music and MTV and all that shit. And it was one of the first metal videos I recall seeing. They were hardly in it, though. And it was shot in Alcatraz, like at the actual prison, eh?
Oh, yeah, right.
I mean, you look at it now and it's like, really? That's the best you could come up with? But hey, it was 82. Okay, number four, You Give Me All I Need. Music, Shanker, lyrics, Herman Rarebell this time. So I love this kind of track from them. Like thinking of other tracks that are like it. Like, is there anybody out there off Love Drive kind of has that same kind of medium pace kind of feel? I love this kind of stuff from them. And I love how they mix it up.
I do too. Although I will say that this one didn't stick with me as much. Like, and the reason I can tell you that is because actually I listened to this album last week, not even before I knew we were going to talk.
Oh, right on.
And I really enjoyed it. But this track, even though I did remember it, you know, I know that it wasn't one of the ones that I had put on my mixtapes or that I had.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, sure.
And I didn't only put the hits on my mixtapes.
Right, I'm sure.
Me neither. I went pretty deep.
Yeah. I thought it struck a good balance between the heavy, you know, heavy chorus and the more ballady verse and stuff. I kind of dig it. Now they rebound. They come at you fucking hard with number five. Now, Music Shanker.
Exclamation
lyrics.
Point.
Yes, exclamation point. Lyrics, Klaus and Herman. This shows their metal side, and it fucking kicks ass. I love this one.
It's a great tune. And to me, Now is what I think about. That's the kind of music when I think about seeing them live. I mean, they were just moving all the time, and they're so high energy. Scorpions were rarely ominous. You know, maybe like the Zoo or Animal Magnetism, songs like that. But yes, they are more like heavy, like, but still kind of fun heavy.
They're having fun. I mean?
That's what Now is to me.
Yes.
Now.
I have to read some lyrics for this one. I can't help myself.
Okay.
Teach me to fly, want to stay high. I have to live it up before I die. Nightlife and booze, girls to choose. Are you ready, baby? Come on, let's cruise. It's going to be wild, going to be wild.
Lenny Kravitz might have stole those for a later album.
Oh, God, I never thought of that. He totally did. Sure. Oh, man.
I wish that I could fly way in the sky, so very high.
Oh, I guarantee he was listening to the Scorpions. Absolutely. Let's go to another one. I love this one. I like this more than Now. Number six, Dynamite. Or as Klaus would say, Dynama.
Yeah. For us, the two tracks that totally got us right off the hop, even maybe more than No One Like You, because we were young rockers, were Blackout and Dynamite.
Yeah, they were.
Dynamite is fucking dynamite. It really is so good. It's a really odd riff. You know, when I saw them on the Blackout tour, I feel like they did most of the album.
They did that back then, man. They would do that.
Yeah.
All those bands would, man. Yeah, it's one of my faves on the album for sure. Absolutely. And I have to do it again. The lyrics are fucking hilarious on this one. You know what they are. Ready? Shoot my heat into your body. Give you all my size. I'm going to beat the beat tonight. It's time to break the ice. That's one chunk. Here's another.
Yeah.
Eat your meat until you're breathless. Twirl your hips around. I'm going to break my neck tonight to get you off the ground. Dynamite! Wow. Like, come on, that's poetry.
Yeah, I'd forgotten about that.
Eat your meat. I remember that standing out. I'm like, what did he just say? Let me put the needle back. What?
What? Eat my what? Yeah,
that's raunchy, dude. But
wait,
yeah.
Who are you talking to here?
When you're in grade 11, this is speaking to me. Absolutely.
Oh, those Germans.
Yeah, that big riff. Fuck, it's right up my alley. And the drums. We haven't talked about the drumming, man. Big drums.
I jammed with Herman Ravel once.
How did that happen?
At Club Soda. We were playing there in Special A.
Okay.
And it was actually, if I remember correctly, it was Bob Rock's stag party. The weirdest group of people got up and jammed. At one point on stage, like I'm standing there watching these people playing our gear. It's Herman Rarebell on the drums, Bob Rock on bass, I think, CC DeVille on guitar, Brett Michaels singing, doing Crossroads.
Holy shit. That's bizarre.
All I got to say is too bad I didn't have an iPhone.
Right. How wasted was CC DeVille?
Sounded pretty wasted, I don't know.
You hope he was, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy, dude.
Yeah.
Okay, man, let's move along. Let's go to number 7, Arizona. Music by Shanker, lyrics by Rarebell again. Don't get me wrong, like, I like the song, but if I had to gas one, it would be this one. If
really?
I had to. Yeah.
Not me. I like this song. This song, to me, is like really mining in that pop direction. In structure, it's almost like a 38 special song or something.
Wow, I never thought of that. Yeah, right.
Do you know what I mean? Like
it
has that kind of majory rock pop sound. And we loved it. I think we used to play it in our basement band as well.
Okay. It is poppier for sure. I do love the solo. The guitar solo, I love it.
I can remember when we were going into the studio as, you know, young kids, we saved up all our money for months so we could go in the studio. And I can remember getting there and telling the producer / engineer that was going to record us on this fateful day that he could do whatever the fuck he wanted, but I wanted my guitar to sound like the guitars on Blackout.
There you go.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Spoiler alert, they didn't.
Shit. Hey, we haven't talked about that. Dieter Dierks is the producer, right?
Dieter Dierks, yeah.
He did all their classic stuff, and the production is phenomenal. Like, it sounds great. Of course, his name's Dieter.
Of course it is.
I want to mention the video for this song, because it is so fucking bad, dude. Have you seen it? The video for Arizona?
No.
I don't know if it got much airplay. Their band's not even in it. I can't even describe how bad it is. It's these college girls dancing around a campus, and it's so fucking bad. It's one of the worst rock videos I've ever seen. Easily.
Really?
It's so bad. On to cut number 8, China White. I love this one. This is Shanker again writing the music, Klaus again with the lyrics. I love when they do this slow, moody, heavy thing. Like on Animal Magnetism, they do it. What's the track on Love at First Sting? They do it. They always throw one of these in. It's a little more serious in tone, like the lyrics are more serious, you know, about the end of the world or whatever. It's cool. It's really cool. I like it a lot.
China White to me is not as powerful as some of their, like, I like The Zoo and Animal Magnetism.
The title track, yeah.
China White hit me less. I mean, I was so engaged with some of the other tracks on this album that China White wasn't one of my favorites. Again, probably didn't make my mixtapes.
I just love the variety, you know? It's cool.
I do too. And it does make for a good album listening experience.
Yes. Okay, speaking of variety, let's go right to number 9, When the Smoke is Going Down. I love this one. Like, I love, you can call it a ballad, call it whatever you want. It's a perfect way of closing the album. It really sets that mood. The end of the concert, the smoke. Man, it's just perfect. It's perfect to end the album. It's great musically. It's great lyrically. It's got it all happening.
It is a great track, without a doubt. And, you know, a nice ending to a killer hard rock album.
Yeah, to me, like, it's your favorite. It's always a toss up between this one and Love Drive for me. It's hard. I love Love Drive. God damn, I love that one.
Love Drive is amazing. It is for sure. And even some of the tracks that initially that I didn't like as much when I was a kid, when I go back and listen to them, I'm like, there's more here than what I was able to appreciate. We talked about Coast to Coast a little bit in our when we were talking about instrumentals and stuff like that.
Yes.
And that's one of my vivid memories of seeing them live was seeing them do Coast to Coast and then doing the,
Damn, that's so great.
yeah, Klaus straps on the guitar and plays the 335 as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, give the smallest guy the biggest guitar.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's wrap up, man. I mean, this is a hard rock metal fucking classic. It just is. Hands
It really
down.
is.
It's just
Yeah.
amazing.
Great cover, great music, great guitar sounds, great songs, really, really crazy ass dirty lyrics. What more
Right?
could you want?
What more could you want? Come on.
Yeah.
Okay, before we leave, I want to mention this. So they released a bunch of their albums a few years ago, deluxe packaging, right? So you get the album, you get bonus tracks, demo versions and shit. But what's cool, not all of them, but a lot of them, like this one, has a live DVD in it. So you get an 83 show where they play Blackout, Loving You Sunday Morning, Coming Home, Always Somewhere, Holiday, Can't Live Without You, Dynamite, Can't Get Enough. That's a rocker. Make It Real and The Zoo. And you get videos for No One Like You and Arizona. Yeah, it's like a lot of these albums in that time. I never tire of it. I mean, that's the review. I never get sick of this stuff. If it comes up, I know why I love it and still do, right?
It's interesting because, unlike you, I'll go long periods of time without listening to it, but which is even more telling because when you can be away from something for such a long time and revisit it and it's immediately familiar and you remember why you loved it so much, that's pretty powerful. And when I hear gank, 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 bow, I still get the same feeling as I did when I first heard it.
Absolutely. I'm the same, man. As usual, let us know what you guys think in the comments. Okay, on behalf of Reed and I, thanks for tuning in. Till next time, keep rock alive. Peace out.
Peace.